Hello. Thank you so much to Frameline for asking me to moderate the panel. I'm super honored and excited to get to chat with some really amazing people and also hear from all of you. So what we're going to do first is show some clips from all of our work, and then I'll hop back up and we'll get going.
I'm a kind of lover who won't run for cover. What kind of lover am I? Come on, baby, I'm loving, loving lazy. What kind of lover am I? Ooh. Ooh. Now put my bed above us, then I'll learn to love us. What kind of lover am I? I'm a little drinker, nervous and a stinker. What kind of lover am I? Little rule breaker, how do I break so well? Oh, a little rule breaker, if you break me, can you tell? Whoa! Heart forever for art. What kind of lover am I? I don't say it, I imply it. I'm a queen of quiet. What kind of lover am I? Ooh, a little rule breaker. How do I break so well? Oh, a little rule breaker. If you break me, can you tell? I'm a kind of lover that won't run for cover. What kind of lover am I? I'm a kind of lover who won't run for cover. What kind of lover am I? Kind of lover. Now what kind of lover am I? Kind of lover.
Is this your first time at Les Meet?
I'm actually covering this for the LA Reader.
So listen, I want to write a piece on transgender women.
Jerry Springer's been on that for like decades.
What about that waitress?
Come on, Vi. Never join us. You have some boyfriend that none of us know about?
I'm Allie.
I'm Violet.
Hi.
Vi.
You are the first trans woman I've ever met.
That you know of.
What do you mean?
You've probably met women who are trans who just didn't disclose to you.
I used to broadcast my team. Tell my whole history before I even hit the first date.
So, tell me everything.
Everything? About what?
You.
All that ever did was to scare people away. They might have actually liked me.
When I'm with a man, I have no doubt about my womanhood. I mean, my body next to theirs is so obviously feminine, but next to, say...
Let's say me.
This whole time, some part of my mind has been noting how much bigger my hands are, or wondering if people are clocking my voice. It's hard to feel totally present with all of that.
All I ever wanted was for someone to see me. And then when someone tries, I'm terrified. It never gets easier for girls like us.
I don't know what to do.
Monster.
Lucy Hicks Anderson was one of the most well-known women in Ventura County during Prohibition. She hosted famously elaborate parties for the richest folks in town, while just across the tracks, she ran a boarding house that provided both liquor and women. And when the people of Ventura found out that she was a trans woman, they challenged her marriage, and she became the first trans person in history to go to court to fight for it.
Well, hello there. I'm Jeffrey Marsh, and I am very queer. Isn't that good? That's why I'm so excited about Frameline, and I'm excited about the panel that I'm going to be on, because I am so queer that they have asked me to talk about being queer and putting it on the internet. Being queer, putting it in a video, and uploading it to the internet. That's me. That's my whole life. I have, gosh, over a quarter of a billion views across social. And when they asked me, when Frameline said they wanted this video, I thought, oh my gosh, I'm going to put together a trailer and I'm going to put all my top, like, millions and millions of views, like whatever those videos are, put them in succession and like a trailer. It's going to be awesome. And then I realized, no, that's not me. This is me. This is what I do. And to me, that's part of telling queer, trans, transgender, genderqueer, LGBTQ stories. It's being willing to connect. You notice my videos do not have jump cuts, and they don't have music underneath, and they don't have a lot of bells and whistles or plain background, right? They don't have a lot of the bells and whistles because I want to connect with you. Not them, not some audience, not something general. You. And I get to do that in person with Frameline. Part of being a queer artist and putting it online is that vulnerability, that willingness to be oneself in the face of hate so that people can recognize themselves in you as an artist. Notice I didn't say queer people can recognize themselves. It's not just that community. It is everyone, and I can't wait to meet everyone. Let's grow the community even more. I'll see you there. Bye.
Oh, I was going to say before we got started that as a trans filmmaker, this work is so important to me personally, and I'm just, again, so honored that Frameline asked me to come up here and do this. Plus, it's really fun to be reunited with some folks who are at Translations up in Seattle with me. So it's my pleasure to introduce the panelists. First, we have Angelica Ross. She's an actor from Her Story and the founder of Trans Tech Social. And you should have seen Her Story last Saturday at the Victoria. And if you missed it, it's okay. It's screening again tonight at the Elmwood at 7. From the boardroom to film sets to the White House, Angelica Ross is a leading figure of success and strength in the movement for trans and racial equality. Angelica grew up performing in choirs at church and at school, in community theater, as well as runway, print modeling, television, and film. When Angelica transitioned at the age of 19, she thought she would have to leave all of that behind. But this year, Angelica Ross returns to the screen and to her dreams in her breakout performance in Her Story. Angelica is also the founder of Trans Tech Social Enterprises, a program that empowers trans and non-binary people through on-the-job training in leadership and workplace skills. Please welcome Angelica Ross to the stage.
Shades are necessary for the shade.
Okay. Next up, we have Jen Richards, writer, producer, actor from Her Story. Jen Richards is a writer, actress, consultant, and advocate who works with national organizations and media projects. She's the co-writer, star, and producer of the groundbreaking web series Her Story, co-producer and writer for the upcoming docu-series More Than Tea, a 2016 Outfest screenwriting fellow, and wrote the June Advocate cover story, wrote the June Advocate cover story, What Trans Movement? She has appeared as herself in BuzzFeed Videos, AOL's True Trans with Laura Jane Grace, The Own Show, and E! I Am Kate. She was the co-founder of and director of the Trans 100 and creator of We Happy Trans. She has published articles, lectured, participated in panels, been interviewed, and led workshops on a variety of topics across the country for 20 years. She is smartass Jen on all social media.
And in real life.
Please welcome Jen Richards to the stage. Yay. Okay. Next up, we have Rhys Ernst, director from This Is Me and We've Been Around, and producer of Transparent. And hopefully you all had a chance to be here, I think, last night to watch those. And if you didn't, I'm sure he can let you know where you can go and see them. Rhys Ernst is a filmmaker and artist. His work investigates transgender identity in the context of larger narratives and seeks to develop and expand the portrayal of trans lives in media. He's a producer on Amazon's Transparent and created the title sequence for the series. Ernst was nominated for a 2015 Emmy Award for directing and producing the web series Transparent, This Is Me, which won a Special Recognition GLAAD Award. In 2016, he teamed up with Focus Features to create the online series We've Been Around, a collection of short films on transgender pioneers. In addition to the 2014 Whitney Biennial, Ernst has shown work at Sundance, Oberhausen, and the Hammer Museum. He's won awards at Outfest, Chicago International Film Festival, and the LA Transgender Film Festival. He was a Point Scholar, a Project Involved Fellow, and was awarded with the 2015 Point Foundation Horizon Award for his work on transgender representation in the media. He lives in Los Angeles and is currently developing a feature film. Please welcome Rhys Ernst to the stage. This is so awesome. Okay. And last but definitely very not least, Jeffrey Marsh, social star and author with Penguin Random House. Host, author, and youth advocate Jeffrey Marsh has more than a quarter billion views across social media. As the creator of the global trends hashtag don't say that so gay and hashtag no time to hate myself, Jeffrey has earned spots on top Viner lists by both BuzzFeed and Vine with a positive, inclusive message. In 2015, Jeffrey was named official red carpet correspondent for both MTV Logo and Glisten, and as a featured writer for the Huffington Post and Medium. Jeffrey is a perceptive facilitator in the Soto Zen tradition of Buddhism, as well as a host, actor, singer, songwriter, dancer, and comedian. In 2016, Penguin Random House will publish Jeffrey's first book, How to Be You. Please welcome Jeffrey Marsh to the stage.
I want to center a black trans woman, so can we have to see this? Thank you.
Well, this is an honor to be sitting with all these amazing people, so I'll do my very best not to totally geek out. It's just such an exciting time for trans and gender expansive media. And before we dive in, I just want to give everyone a sense of the overarching themes that I foresee in the conversation, and of course, things will go as they will. First off is a general progression of trans and gender expansive stories from film, wait, I should do it from your perspective, from film to TV to online, like Netflix and Amazon, and to user-generated content like YouTube. The second thing is who's telling the stories, who's controlling that representation, and along the same lines that Alexis was talking about of in whose image. And the third is who's the audience, who's this media intended to serve? And I think in general, we're seeing a change, and we'll talk about this more, from cisgender people controlling the media, moving into trans people representing themselves on screen. And as I like to say, cis for cis and trans for trans, because that kind of sounds like a personals ad, and I think it's funny. So that's our overarching thing, and I figure we'll just jump in. So first off, I'd like to paint a picture of the trajectory of how trans representation has gone over time. I'm curious, when was the first time that each of you saw a trans or gender expansive person on screen? What kind of impact did it have on you? And if you want to elaborate on those three initial points, what type of media was it, who was making it, and who was it for? But even more than that, just who did you see, and what did you see, and how did it impact you?
Start over there.
Sure. Although Harvey Fierstein would not exactly identify as trans, those were some of the first trans images I saw growing up on a farm in Pennsylvania. So it was a film by someone I would consider genderqueer, making that story for a broad, broad audience. That happened to include my parents, who reacted quite negatively to those images, but I reacted positively, and I think that's what counts.
I have kind of recently remembered an experience I had when I think I was about 8 or 9, and I was watching daytime TV at some talk show, and there was a trans man on the talk show, and it was a really sad depiction, and I felt so sorry for this person, and I felt the way, you know, he didn't really have any claim to dignity the way it was set up, and the whole thing was just so depressing, and I recognized it myself that that was me, and I literally turned off the television and walked outside and, you know, recognized that that was me and decided to repress it because of that moment. And so to kind of remember that later in my life and realize how media affected me in such a negative way, I think that's so core to now the work that I'm trying to do and to my whole evolution and as a trans filmmaker.
It's on your heel. There we go, okay. Yeah, so I think I definitely remember being at home and having the TV be on in the living room and walking past and for me some very early images being the girls on Jerry Springer and seeing that in the media and then shortly after you know, I think it was something along the lines of The Crying Game. And so I normally, growing up in a very Christian household, had very negative, traumatic, or like dismal portrayals of trans people, mostly of trans people of color. And then as I grew up and as things went along and I started to see any sort of respectful depictions, it then wasn't of people of color, it was then of the normal and trans America and just other stories. I saw basically a whitening of, you know, sort of the community and needing to basically maybe start from a place where they're trying to connect to a general population and say, look, even these folks here experience trans stuff, so if we can start to respect them, then maybe it'll trickle down type politics. But yeah, that was my experience.
The earliest I remember is there was a TV show a long time ago called Soap, which is a primetime kind of comedy, and Billy Crystal played, I think it was one of the very first, I know he was a gay father, I know that was the first, but there must have been some scenes of him in drag, because of course, you know, prior to fairly recently, transsexual, transvestite, crossdresser, drag queen were all kind of conflated, but I must have been like 5 years old, and I can remember like being on a hotel bed and watching Billy Crystal on Soap, being really fascinated. And then as I was younger, it was definitely the Jerry Springer girls, just like, you know, watching and trying not to let other people watch you watch. But for me, the biggest one, I think the one that really like landed in my consciousness was Candace Cane on Dirty Sexy Money, because by the time that was airing, I already felt like this was something happening inside me, but I didn't want to admit it. And so she would come on screen, and it was like time stopped, and I could just like every moment of her was just so filled for me, and I was trying to like not to let other people notice how important those moments were for me.
And even just to back up on that, for Candace to be on Dirty Sexy Money and to have that, Candace was actually someone who, to many of us trans women, we looked up to her way before that because of the pageantry. So being able to see her visibly in these pageants and want to, you know, aspire to be that type of performer, that type of woman, to have that kind of grace, like we were already there and fans of hers. So I think there's a fan base for many trans women like Candace already built in once we get the exposure.
And then she was also a love interest, and it was a primetime show. show, and you know, a bald one love interest too at that. So, go girl.
I just think it's so interesting because it always depends on where you grew up, the culture, like your family, all kinds of things really influence what those first images were for all of us. And I think it's so funny because for me, I think the first image that I saw, I didn't even really think it was anything even unusual, was my family's favorite movie is The Birdcage. And so it was Albert on The Birdcage. And it was, I could tell that there was shame around it, but there was also so much love in the family, and so I could tell that it was complicated, but it never even occurred to me until way later that that was like the first time that was even planted in my head, because I didn't even notice.
Well, and to this day, it's the highest grossing, you know, LGBT film globally.
Is it really?
Absolutely. So that's an entry point for a lot of people.
Are you talking about the French one?
No.
The first one.
The one with Robin Williams and Nathan Lane. Yeah.
I remember renting the French one and being this, I was in college at the time, and just being totally bowled over that the French were so far ahead of us. And come to find out that it's complicated everywhere. The
Definitely.
Stories are complicated everywhere.
Definitely. Thank you all for sharing those. I was curious if I could ask Rhys a question, since going even further back, I was curious how you found the stories for the We've Been Around series, and specifically what sources are out there, and thank you so much for breathing new life into these stories.
Thanks. Yeah, for those of you guys who haven't seen the series yet, I have a new series called We've Been Around that's a collection of short films on transgender pioneers throughout history, and they're each about 5 minutes long. You can watch the whole series for free on WeBeenAround.com, so check it out and tweet and tell your friends. Early on that project brought on Susan Stryker, who is an academic and a filmmaker, and wrote a book called Transgender History, and she's completely amazing and was an incredible guide. And some of the stories I've known of, like the six shorts we have right now are Albert Cashier, who's a trans man who fought in the Civil War. Lucy Hicks Anderson, you saw the preview of. She was a trans woman in Oxnard, California during Prohibition, who fought for her marriage rights in court. Little Axe was a trans man gospel singer who was stealth his whole life and played, sang in huge acts all over the country. He was really popular singer for about 40 years. Star, Sylvia Rivera and Marsha P. Johnson, probably one of the better known stories. And what else am I forgetting? Oh, Lou Sullivan, San Franciscan gay trans man who was also an HIV/AIDS activist. And then we more recently made a film on Camp Trans, which was the resistance sort of protest group that came out to protest the Women Board Women policy at Michigan Women's Festival. So I tried to really, you know, cover a wide range of era and also types of folks in gender, and in, you know, keeping it racially diverse and just trying to represent as much as possible, which is obviously, you know, representing trans community is kind of an impossible task, because if there's one thing, you know, the one takeaway when you're first learning about the trans community is there is no one way to be trans, and it affects so many different types of communities from race and class and nationality, religion. It's completely like a lottery, you know, who ends up being trans. So it's an impossible task to represent the whole community. But of course, what we need is more stories and more different types of stories and more different types of voices and more kinds of representation. So I just tried to, you know, spread it out as much as possible and be really inclusive in the filmmaking, bring in a lot of trans talent to collaborate. The animator and the composer are both trans. All the voiceover actors are trans. One of the camera people and so on. And, you know, it just kind of takes a village, and I, you know, really took a lot of input from people, from what they would like to see or what hasn't been told. And there's so many more. I feel like it's just the beginning. And one thing I was sort of regretful about is that all the stories are in the US. I would have liked to have made it more international, but it was kind of a starting point. And getting into histories that are not very well documented in other languages was a higher bar than I was able to get to in the first round. But if I end up making any more, it's definitely a goal to expand it even further.
Very cool. So,
can
oh,
I just
yeah,
add
go ahead.
One quick little resource? Because Morgan Page is a trans woman in Canada who started a podcast recently called One from the Vaults, where she is similarly doing trans history, and she's each episode is kind of a deep dive into one particular segment, and she's been going into all kinds of archives and pulling out stories that I'd never heard before and doing really, really great work. And I feel like if we evoke the history of Sylvia Rivera, we have to like recognize that Raina Gossett in New York at the Sylvia Rivera Law Project was one of the people that was really pushing and found a lot of that archival footage, which we now see as iconic.
Can you say that website one more time?
The podcast is One from the Vaults.
One from the Vaults. Okay.
Yes, Morgan Page. She's great.
Awesome. Moving a little more forward in history, so we're going through history. In terms of film festivals, I'm curious how you all feel about representation of trans stories over the years. For me, these representations have been really validating and empowering, but I also kind of recognize that they don't get the same kind of mainstream reach as a lot of other media does, just because that's where I see all my movies, with the exception of like Finding Dory. I'm not the majority. So I'm curious, how do we reach further? So that's kind of two questions. How do you feel about how the representation has been? Were there any standout moments for you that really jump out? And how far do we need to go?
I would say, there have been some very standout moments. And I think the standout moments for me actually are the moment where Hollywood tries to erase us and the community says, I don't think so. And so I think those moments with Dallas Buyers Club, with Stonewall.
Nice try.
Right. With a lot of these movies, you know, but in particular, I thought the one that was very poignant for me was Tangerine. And I think it's such a poignant project because it really illustrates sort of where we are with how we've come along with seeing those stories. So yes, you know, I, just like Kerry Washington as an actor, I want to be able to play complicated stories. I want to be able to play not just the positive thing, but things that are a little bit complicated. And so I know that some people in our communities are like, well, we don't want to keep seeing these stories of people of color in these tragic places or what have you, but those stories are part of our community and do deserve to be told. However, I think that we still need to be careful about who's telling those stories. So I think and this is where we get into, again, the conversation around, well, but it's done so much good. Because no one's sort of denying these things, like any progress, any bit of pushing that needle forward is wonderful, is great. But when you are in a position of power and you can do more, you should do more, and you should try to do better when you know better. And so I think in those moments when I'm looking at Tangerine, I know the girls. And I know the story behind that. And I know, just like sort of white supremacy typically tends to work, is that it will leave her right where they found her. And the award goes to someone that is not that close to the heart of the story. And so I think we're still seeing a marginalization and an appropriation, just a lot of things where we are trying to bring these stories forward and people are crowning themselves as the ones who are most equipped to tell these stories because of whatever the system has told them, academia, experience, the way they tell stories, instead of knowing that creativity is the space for people to come out of the blue to be able to learn to tell stories. So it's not so technical always, and that we can also empower other people by not just putting the lens on them, but bringing them behind the lens.
I can talk a little bit about where we might go next. And that, you know, in the social world, social is the great equalizer a story like mine to connect. If you look at the demographics of who watches my videos, it's a lot of LGBTQ people, and it is a lot of cis people. You were saying cis for cis and trans for trans, but in the social sphere, if someone sees something and connects to it, they share it, regardless of where that person came from, and in my experience, what they look like, what their history is. To me, that kind of self-distribution and self-empowerment is the great connector and is the thing that will bring our community closer to the other community, in quotes, air quotes, the other communities that are out there. It's what's going to bring all of the work that I do is lacking. You know, on Vine, the videos are 6.5 seconds long. Talk about filmmaking needing to be pared down. And one of the things that goes is character. I'm not portraying a character. It is a trans story. It goes right through me into that lens. And as far as I can tell, right through that lens into their hearts.
I just wanted to echo a bit more of what Angelica was saying. I think it's so important that, you know, I worry sometimes that this moment, the worst case scenario would be this media moment, that it would be a trend and a phase, and then this stuff goes away, and then we're kind of back where we started, exactly what you said, leaving people where they started. And that's really the danger of the sort of the sensationalism about this trans media movement that's happening right now. I've been lucky to have been a part, like, bigger of more establishment Hollywood projects like Transparent, and one of the things I've wanted to do with that situation is to try to bring people into the process as much as possible. And it's a work in progress, and it's kind of never enough. It's like always like, we all gotta get on this boat, come on, get on, and try to get as many people on as possible. And you know, sometimes certain people are really empowered by that and are really able to ascend up the ladder or create their own work, and sometimes it's not a fit, and it doesn't work out, and they don't wanna continue in that direction. So it's an imperfect process. But one of my goals is to try to help empower trans people, especially to be behind the camera. It's important to be in front of the camera, and I think there's been a lot of conversation about that in our community. And it's really important to use that as leverage, too, to hold Hollywood accountable, because oftentimes when you're not seeing a trans person in a trans role, you know, 90-something percent of the time it's because it's a lazy decision that you know, is about disinclusion and keeping the same people in the spotlight over and over and over again. So it's a very important litmus test of the responsibility index of the production. But on the other hand, I do want to point out, you know, what Angelica is pointing to too, which is that, you know, empowering people to be the storytellers, that is really the future, and that's really where I want to see things go, is trans people telling stories, authoring stories, being a writer, making films, making short films, being, you know, directing features, shorts, television, show running, you know, like that's really how we're going to affect change long term, whether or not the content is always about trans issues. So I hope that we're all, you know, I hope that that's the result of this moment that we're in right now.
Yeah, that that goes right into the next question, which is perfect. The whole concept of in whose image, I mean, that's what we're talking about. It's who's controlling the camera, who's in front of the camera, and who's making those decisions about how trans people are being represented. And specifically, what I like to talk about is the trans new wave. Okay. So I didn't make it up. Jed Bell did, but Jed Bell says I made it up. But anyway, the trans new wave is this idea that audiences, we can assume that audiences have a trans 101 in their back pocket, and we're free to tell stories that have trans people in them, but their transness is not the story. Their transness is just part of who they are, and the story is all the other things about being alive. And so for me, I'm seeing this moment as a delicate balance between media that is made in the vein of the trans new wave and also media that's made to be accessible for helping allies understand the trans experience. And those are two kind of different things. And so I'm curious what you all think about how you do that in your own work. For me, I try and strike a balance so that it's accessible to everyone, but sometimes I don't want to. Sometimes I just want to do trans new wave things. And it's so important when making work and thinking about who your audience is and how they're going to connect. So I'm just curious if any of you have thoughts on that for your own work.
Well, if it's heartening at all, most of this community that I've created online is young people, and they're already there. I mean, they're beyond new wave. They ask strangers what their pronouns are on the street. And it is also so heartening when their mom writes to me and says, "My kid showed me your video. Now I understand. Now I get it." They were going to, I still get messages every single day. "I was feeling suicidal. I've decided to stick around because I saw your video." And when that comes from a cis person, someone who's not, someone who, what's the opposite of new wave? Trans old wave?
Traditional trans narratives.
Somebody who's used to that from traditional media, and sees through that to find humanity in someone is a powerful thing.
All right, going back to say the question again, that combination of new wave and versus making stuff that's more accessible.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of feel like with her story, we kind of split the difference because we had this woman as a reporter, so there was an excuse for her to ask questions. But that's also reflective of my experience as a trans woman who's often the only trans person in a circle of people, so that is part of my experience. But the feature that I'm working on right now that's at Outfest, the screenwriting lab, it's about three trans women. And I don't think stuff really comes up much. They're all three, I wouldn't quite exactly say stealth, but they're like in their 30s, they're into their careers, they have relationships. It's not a new thing. And so a lot of their, you know, their issues and the dramas are kind of interpersonal. But then the docuseries that we have coming out shortly is called More Than Tea. And the whole premise is that we're looking at these different subjects who happen to be trans, but you can't lead with that. They're more than just T. And I scripted a bunch of PSAs to go with it that are called Trans 102, which kind of assumes a basic level introduction. Says, okay, let's just go a little bit further with that. So I think it's just it's having all the tools in your toolbox.
For me, I think it's about graduating sometimes. And I think Beyonce, to bring up Beyonce, yes. I think Beyonce illustrates it very well that not all content is made for everybody. And that you can have a specific audience in mind. And that other people just need to get with the program. And, you know, when they kind of, because, you know, I there's an assumption. Again, it always goes down to, for me, I always, you know, I'm just gonna always go back to white supremacy. Sorry, y'all. I'm always going to go there. But when it comes back to, let's say, we talk about movies a lot. Jen and I at home, we go back and forth, and she always has there's always these references and cultural references that I'm just sort of expected to know or understand, and it's created in a way that I'm expected to understand that the audience should know these things. And so I think about the days that we can get to that place, and I don't think that day is too much in the future, because I can tell when there is content that wasn't meant, that was made for a white cis gaze, you know? And so, you know, Orange is New Black, there's some things that have been going on in that there, I can tell that they were made for a certain thing and not coming from the right perspective. So Yeah, I guess for me, I have gotten to a place of feeling very comfortable of creating the message that I'm creating and letting other people find the cliff notes or other people to explain it to them.
Yeah, and I know that when we were doing Her Story, our kind of audience, we always thought our audience is other trans women. Like, if there's an audience of 300 people and there's two trans women in the audience, those are the only two people I care about. I don't care what anyone else leaves with. Now, granted, we're part of a much bigger team and everyone cares about everyone else and people want to make money and all these things, and that's important, but ultimately, personally, on a kind of gut spiritual level, that's my audience.
But what she's also talking about is centering a trans woman. So the more you center a marginalized identity in a story, the more other people can relate.
Yeah, that's the particular becomes universal if you do it well enough.
So again, it's better to not have me sitting in the middle of the audience feeling left out and marginalized by a story. Instead, can you write and create stories where everyone feels like they see themselves in it?
Yeah, thanks for bringing that up, Jen. I was gonna say bring up the adage of the more specific, the more universal, because literally, and thinking about the kind of transplainer, you know, pre-101 version, I think that those have been not very effective in terms of entertainment. They're just like not interesting for so long. So I think that's what we grew up on, what we saw for years and years and years, that frankly was kind of poor entertainment. So I think it's actually an interesting thing when you do try to talk directly to the level that you're already thinking on and find that everyone actually can catch up. And it's actually better, it's more interesting to people. And I guess that, you know, I think it's that adage, but I think it also has to do with sort of narrative theory a little bit too, of like, you know, not having too much exposition and explanation and the whole thing about cinema and storytelling being so directly related to empathy. And if you can put somebody inside of someone else's experience very directly, that's very real and very human, that's so much more compelling than trying to have someone eat vegetables and explain something to them.
Angelica and I went to see a documentary the other day called Real Boy, which I think is playing again, and absolutely see it if you can.
Tomorrow night.
So we went in because our friend Joe Stevens is in it, but like, I, you know, we're walking over and I'm warning Angelica, like, listen, this is about a bunch of middle-class white trans guys, so it's not for us. And at the end, we're like, oh my God, that's me, I get that, you know? Because it was just so well done. It was just, the focus was so good. It ended up transcending its particularities. And I was talking with the filmmaker, you know, afterwards. She's like, I knew it was a white class, you know, a middle white class story. She's like, but that was the story. And I'm not going to pretend it's something it's not. So it's just a matter of how well can you do that story, while also addressing the system that makes those stories easier to make than others.
Yes, if it's really well done, it's like a little broccoli in the cupcake that they take away.
I don't want any broccoli in my cupcake.
Sorry.
Wait, what does that mean?
Cook the broccoli really well.
It's like the vitamin K in the cupcake that tastes great. But no, they take away the humanity from if it's done well. Yeah.
Well, and there's sometimes I'll get a script in the mail, like, you know, as actresses, we'll get stuff. Our issue, this always cracks me up, we get called in for trans parts in Hollywood now and then get told we don't look trans enough. That's a real thing. That's a consistent real thing. But I read these scripts sometimes and I'm just like, my only thought is, you've never actually met a trans person, have you? It's just this concept, like, oh, wouldn't it be interesting if, you know, the killer was actually themselves, you know, the whole time. Or, you know, it's we're just like these tropes, these kind of things. Or tragedies. I mean, Rhys and I both worked on, I'm not going to out you, am I?
Oh, you can go ahead.
Okay. We both worked on The Danish Girl, and we didn't have input, let me put that differently. I disagreed with the way the movie was done, a lot of aspects of it, and Tom Hooper and I would get in some pretty strident arguments about it, and I don't like how the story is handled. It's just one of those many examples of it, but it wasn't for me. It was about us, but didn't include us in some ways. It included us in other ways, and I think we did have an impact, and we mitigated some of the damage. You know, it could have been worse, et cetera. But it's just like, this was a tragedy for cis consumption, you know, that had no trans people involved at the level of the novel that was written, and the director, the producers, or the stars.
I was going to say before, it reminds me, this conversation about audience reminds me of the concentric circles of audience that we talked about a lot in the grad school I went to. And it's like, you have your central circle. So like, as you were saying, if there were two trans women in the audience, they're like in the middle of that that very central circle. And then you have one circle out from that that maybe is, I don't know. I mean, it all depends on each topic. And it goes out and it goes out and it goes out. And people can understand things on different levels. And I really like how you're all saying, let's just say what we want to say, and they can catch up to it. So maybe they're getting to the center. They're trying to understand it. I just really like that. There's something about it that we're making media that we want a lot of people to see, but that we have a particular type of person in mind who we hope it resonates for, who it helps empower, all of that.
Well, and I also say, I'm sorry.
No, go ahead. Well, I was just going to say that there's this saying that the truth needs no defense. And so I think that what happens is the more authentic a story is, and you see authentic storytelling, when you sit two things next to each other, like, and we see these authentic stories, even if they don't have sort of the power behind them, I'm seeing the sort of social impact or social justice or restorative justice to narratives or storytelling where, you know, we think of power dynamics and we think of blockbuster budgets and things like that, and we think of money and power. And I think we are entering into a new age from what we've seen, how social media has affected political things, of how people, when a story is told really well, or when something just puts the truth right out there in front of your face and you can't deny it, it then becomes in competition with those things that we are now noticing are mediocre, are not as great as we have been led to believe because we haven't been allowed to see anything else.
Yeah, I think a great story is a complicated one.
Yeah.
And to go from simplicity to complication is the mark of growing up as an artist. I can remember getting, you know, as a kid, feeling used to people hating me. And so if I could get them to pity me, that's at least a step in the right direction, right? But it's a one-dimensional step. They only have one intersection point with me, and I am multiplicitous, right? So to be able to tell those stories on all those layers and hit all the points, again, as specific as the artistic statement can be, then it becomes universal for people to plug into all those different complicated entry points.
Yeah, I was going to say, with the clip that I showed, which was from Dating Sucks, A Genderqueer Misadventure.
It's so cute, the whole
thing.
Thank you. Yeah. It's really sweet. You should see it if you can.
You're real nice.
No, I'm not nice. I don't say it unless it really is.
She's
good.
Really not nice.
Okay.
What's your Twitter name?
Smart-ass Jen.
Smart-ass Jen.
It could be smart-ass bitch, but, you know, that's my girl.
Anyway.
That was a very nice thing to say. How's that? I was just going to say, the reason that I think it's actually so interesting is that so many different people relate to my story. My story is about a trans person who's genderqueer and confused about their sexuality, and I was 100% sure that I was the only person out there who was confused. That's why, like, there was that part where I was in a glass box and it said sexually confused at the bottom, and it was as if I was on display in a museum because that's how I felt. I thought it was only me. But as I've screened it all over the place, all kinds of people come up to me who I didn't think would relate to it at all, and they say, oh my God, that was me. I'm in that glass box with you. In fact, that glass box is really big and there's a lot of us in there with you. So yeah, it's the whole being really specific is actually so universal. The more personal, the more universal, which is so interesting because it sounds like that doesn't work, but it does.
Yeah, well, and I'd also add that I think we feel a moral obligation to push ourselves as artists to complicate issues and to understand perspectives different than our own. But I would encourage audiences to do the same. I mean, to like seek out work that doesn't interest you or that challenges you or that is out, you know, see foreign films, see films that are about subcultures that you might bump up against. See, like, I often will go seek out something I don't understand. Like, I don't get that. So
like,
let me.
Like furries that you
yeah,
did?
Yeah, yeah. No, I walked into a documentary the night on furries, and I had zero interest and zero, like, I didn't get it. I didn't want to get it. And I actually loved it. It was a brilliant documentary, and it became a whole metaphor for the way that subcultures devolve into respectability politics. And I ended up getting an understanding of that thing. I still don't. It doesn't resonate with me personally, but I feel like I get it now. one of the more common questions we got at the start of the Her Story tour was, what about non-binary representation? Which I get, because there's a lot of people in our community that are non-binary, but that's a new thing for me, and I didn't get it at first. And I sat down with one of my friends who's non-binary and said, can I ask you some really awful questions? And like, had a really awkward conversation, because I didn't get it. And you know, I've
had that conversation so many times.
I'm sure you have. I still got questions for you.
Well, that's the thing, is like, when people ask me about it, I say, well, don't feel bad asking me. I mean, of course, ask if I want to answer the question, but I didn't know any of this until I lived it. So how are you supposed to know it? So yes. That's kind of how I approach it.
Yeah. And there's also that other side of the coin where people will catch up to you. Well, you don't always have to have a reason for living, reason for being who you are. And to be able to tell your story honestly is a sign of your own self-respect.
I like that.
Sam has so many notes. It's adorable.
It's a lot.
The most prepared.
It's a lot. I
moderator ever.
Okay. Thanks, Jen. So, Jen, I read that you said we're in the Sydney Poitier phase of trans representation. I'm just curious if you could expand upon that.
Sure. I think I'm quoting Janet Mock there, though, when I say that.
Oh, okay.
I think she said that before me. The idea is that within Black representation and film particularly, there was a period where, you know, Sidney Poitier was the biggest, most important, you know, Black actor and the first one to achieve a kind of mainstream success. But it was because he was the most handsome, the most eloquent, the most refined, the absolute most unimpugnable possible character, so that you couldn't find any fault with him. And I feel like in trans representation, that's kind of where we've been, where we have to have someone like Janet herself, who is unimpugnable, who is so careful about everything she does and says and how it's framed in the culture, she becomes unimpugnable. You know, like no one could object to her. And it's a lot, that's a heavy burden on Janet, on Laverne, on Angelica. It's a lot. And we're not at a point yet where, well, I guess it's up to us to push that to get to the point where we can have complicated people and anti-heroes. And the fuller version of her story, you know, our characters get into some shit and they do selfish, you know, destructive things. And one of the villains turns out to be a trans woman. And I think that's important because we need to get to that point if we're going to be really fully human. But right now in pop culture, we're still very much in that, you know, the respectability politics phase.
On social, you kind of let it all hang out sometimes.
Do you?
And so, well,
I don't. She doesn't. She's removed from social. Yeah, yeah.
In the sense that you have your good days, your bad days, and all of that goes into creating content. So there, if you see my videos, there's obviously a point of view and there's an art direction in a sense, but there's also, if I'm feeling something, it comes right across. There's not a filtering of it. I think that is one of the places where it seems to be where at least young people go to see those not so filtered representations of themselves.
I feel like it's a different world. I mean, I get people warning me, like, girl, you keep saying that you're not going to get work anymore. Like, I'm already alienating people
on social.
Yeah, when yeah. Say things I say on Twitter.
Yeah, so there's a difference. So, like, on social media, and it's a funny thing that only certain people are allowed that non-filter to say whatever you want, whenever you want, and how you feel. You know, I was shaking as I wrote the Huffington Post article about Caitlyn Jenner, you know, and voicing my own experience of what I've done. So the more sometimes you get into needing to collaborate with the entire industry or with the entire community around things who are in different places of understanding with things, we are experiencing a lot of don't say this, don't do this, you know, people wanting to filter our experiences in a lot of different ways. And even in the authentic portrayal of who we are, or the portrayals of our characters on screen that do look like me, that with makeup or without makeup, when I pull my hair back, that are, you know, Snatched, yeah. No, but just saying that, so, but I get villainized a lot every time I'm on screen, but yet, is my story valid too? Is my journey valid too? When I am going through all of the things I'm going through, I've learned about privilege to not talk about, you know, certain things or what have you, but we tend to, when we see these stories, feel like, because someone else is getting something, it's taking away from me, or it's taking away from an opportunity for me, instead of understanding that there's room for your story, but I'm not the one who's supposed to tell it. You are the one that's supposed to tell your story. Of course I don't represent you as a cis-normative person, because I'm cis-normative, you're not. So let me represent myself, and I hope that we get to a place within media and within storytelling is where our community and those folks who are in it are not looking on the screen and looking for their stories to be told and looking to be represented and saying, you know, this, and always calling out, this doesn't represent me well, but focus on how well they're representing themselves, both in their lives and the way that they tell their own stories. But even in saying that is not to villainize as a person alone, because they haven't had the space and the practice to tell their stories where everything's not at stake. Everyone feels like they want to go into an American Idol or get discovered in 2 days, and feels like because of the way they see certain things, and again, this is how the system works, because they pluck people out of situations, and it doesn't always respect the craft. It doesn't always respect those who have worked really hard for the situations. So we have got to be able to create more situations where people have access to play on a very low level, writing community plays, singing at bar mitzvahs, you know, doing all of that kind of stuff, so they can build up the longevity and the work that we know, the 10,000 hours that it takes to do something great, that they learn to edit everything instead of feeling like this is my one shot.
That's such a good point, and I think about things like that quite a lot, and how unfortunate it is that this economy of scarcity that we all feel in the trans community really pits us against each other. And it's just so sad to me when I see a trans project or a trans production by trans people that gets an internet takedown. And you know, sometimes there's some weird stuff going on or not, or maybe it's minute, and I'm not even thinking of a specific example, but the fact that we're taking that kind of stuff down instead of like Entourage or whatever just seems, or CSI, I mean, it just seems so bananas to me that we spend so much time nitpicking work created by trans people. I know it's not a universal thing that we're all doing, but there is an aspect of that in our culture right now. And of course we need to be scrutinizing to some degree about representation, and that's how we've come up, and that's our lens, rightfully so, at trans representation because of the horrible history that we've had of trans representation. But we also need to be, exactly what you were saying, giving space for people to play and fail and try again. Because this shit is hard, and it takes a lot of work, and it takes a lot of tries. Filmmaking is really hard. I mean, anybody who's made more than a couple films knows that you have to make a stinker at some point, because that's a part of the process, and then you feel really bad about it because it was expensive, and a lot of people worked for free, and et cetera, et cetera. And you're ashamed, and then you have to kind of like bounce back and continue to make more stuff. So to have the added fear of, you know, the whole community maybe, you know, swirling around you in anger, it can be a very, you know, destabilizing thing and can really inhibit progress.
Do you feel like that's getting better, though? I feel, I could be wrong, maybe just because I've isolated myself so much, but I feel like over the last year, because with the increase in representation, with having 2 full seasons of I Am Kate, 3 seasons of Transparent, like the different movies and new, so many more people who are in the spotlight, that there's been less pressure and less critique? Do y'all feel that?
I wonder, what do you all think?
Well, I think some of the critique comes depending on the level of which people feel there's a responsibility. So I think there's becoming a little bit more of a awareness around how much power folks have in a situation, meaning like if it's a low budget type project versus if it's a Hollywood project. So then when we look at crowdsourcing and things like that, and I see a lot of films and projects and things like that being crowdsourced, that is where I think some of the conflict comes into, because crowdsourcing is about your networks. And what happens is,
projects of colors don't usually get funded through those because of different dynamics of networks and being able to ask for that money. So when you see a project, let's say like Major or these things that I'm just naming a project, but from the past, and you see a project that's like a project with people of color, and then you see a project that's not with people of color, and you see it gets funded like that, you know, that's where I think people are like, here we go again on now another story that does not have these other intersections is about to get told, and we feel powerless in there. And then their only, you know, and then their only power is sometimes some folks feel their only power is in to tear something else down. And there are some, it's like there's some understanding in why people's emotions or why people would feel certain ways. But I'm hoping to, and we are hoping to, and a lot of people are hoping to model what it looks like to be angry and to be upset about something and put it in your work.
That's the ultimate responsibility. Yep, put it into your own work.
Also, I'm so glad you mentioned Major. That film is so good. I don't think it's playing here,
no,
but it's so good. Everyone should try to see it. I think it's
last year, yeah, at the Castro.
Oh, it did. Good. It's so. It's anyway. It's an amazing film.
It played at the San Francisco Transgender Film Festival to a sold-out Castro screening. I was there. It was awesome. Yeah. Super good movie. I think it's like the Major dot doc.
There's something there.
I see it. Thank you. The Major doc.com.org. Sorry.
If you look,
just
Google
it.
Yeah. Major film.
Yeah.
Sam,
yes.
I will also say that the internet is the enemy of subtlety. It is hard to have a complicated dialogue
in
a Twitter war.
Yes, yes.
Right.
Exactly.
Yeah, right.
And it's hard to give voice to people that deserve a voice if there is not that broader societal matrix set up to give them a voice.
I think we also have to be careful about the word deserve, like, and I think, and this comes from my, like, I'm a little conservative, I guess, in these respects, but art challenges you, and it makes you step up in a way. And so I feel like there's so many people who want to be heard, whose voices want to be heard, but communication is an art. Communication is an art, and so you learn as an artist, how do I break through? So I don't think that there's just an automatic thing of every voice needs to be heard, but it's a lesson in how do you communicate to the world who you are? How do you break through the sound barrier?
And social can be a place to play, like
Absolutely,
you were saying.
Yeah.
I just had another question about this, and then I'll open it up to the audience for a bit. Jeffrey, I'd love to hear from you about your work and how you actively engage your audience. I think that that seems to be something that's a bit unique about your stuff, and encouraging them to be themselves, and especially non-binary and youth. How did you get into making these videos, and what is your model that you use and your goals?
Wow, there was a lot there.
Sorry. I can pare it down if you want. What is your model for making films to really engage your audience?
I think telling the truth is essential, and that's where it always starts. And it is those, you know, if you're having a bad day, that goes in the feed, and if you're not, it doesn't. And in, you know, I'll let you in on a little jargon. In the social world, we call them thumb stoppers, that people are walking around. What is that thing that stops the thumb? And once you are a thumb stopper, once you've got them, what have you got to say? And it had, I'm going to choose my words carefully. It makes my heart sing when it's more than a racist joke or attacking somebody you don't know on the street and filming it, right? It needs to have that depth and that humanity in order for it to be shareable from there. For me, people have built their careers in various ways on social, obviously, but I strive to tell a story that works heart to heart. And I think especially young people are primed for that type of message.
I lied. I have one more question, and then I'm going to open it up. Angelica, I was curious if you could talk about the real life impact kind of stuff, especially with trans tech social. And if there's any particular stories you'd like to share from that experience and starting that program.
You know, I think the most standout sort of connection and experience with trans tech is my experience, I think, on I Am Kate, and is the fact that you know, I had an opportunity to bring light and word to an organization that was created that was not about my own ego or my own this, that, and the other, but about showing how trans people can be involved in their own saving, in their own liberation, teaching themselves and skill sharing. Taking inventory, trans tech is a mission to really take inventory of the value and the skills that we already have in the trans community, using that to fuel and to teach and to build our community, but not in a way that, you know, in this way that feels like I had some people who wanted to be image consultants, and they thought that I'm going to show another trans person how to bring their image together, and I'm thinking, and what are they going to pay you with? We're not here to make money off of each other, but we're here to sort of build value off one another and with one another. And I felt like coming to, you know, to I Am Kate, this was one of those stories where this is what happens in media a lot with trans people of color. We are marginalized, and if I, someone who has caught the eye of MSNBC, of Fast Company magazine, of all of these different, of the Trevor Noah and the Daily Show, of all these things, and they see and can tell my story in certain ways, but yet I could still be marginalized in that. So that people, it didn't make it to the surface that the story of trans tech is about a trans woman who had been fired from job after job, who was told by the world that she had no value unless you were taking your clothes off or you were on stage. And a trans woman who decided to change that narrative and to say that I could be in control of my own value, I could set my value. I don't care if it's on the street, I can say that on the street I deserve more. I don't care if it's laying on a bed and behind on an internet, I can say I deserve more. I don't care if it's in a nonprofit organization, I can say that I deserve more. I can even say, you know what? I have the audacity to think I can start my own business. But it's all about them being involved at every stage of that. But yet, as we're all sitting there on I Am Kate, it's not just having trans people in, you know, these positions of power, it's having trans people with an intersectional lens and an understanding. Because although Caitlin was executive producer of that, in my eye then, she had a hand in the marginalization of my story and creates this narrative of her saving this other girl. My story, your story has touched me so much, let me save you, and all I was labeled as was a sex worker by the end of the episode, as the LA Times recapped it. This is media. This is how it goes out from video all over the world, then into print. So, you know, luckily, I had the courage to stand up against the system, because the system really could have sued my ass. They could have sued my black ass, but I was betting that they weren't gonna sue my black trans ass, because that would be messed up. And that would be the most example of taking a trans woman's story from her, taking her truth from her.
Thank you. Okay, I'm actually doing it. If we have questions from the audience, I'm gonna give this mic and you can just ask.
Thank you. Stand to meet you. So firstly, Jeffrey, thank you so much, because actually one of your vines really helped me to come out as an androgen. So
Yay!
That was really great. And then secondly, so I actually go to a university in the Midwest, and I go for social work. And part of my program and part of my training is we don't talk about non-binary, we don't talk about trans lives, we talk about the very like binary cisnormative system. So what I have struggles with then are when I hear, you know, my other like trans siblings in the university who say, I don't know, for instance, like, oh, you know, I really love the Danish girl because, you know, it was just, it was so cute and, you know, Eddie Redmayne looked so good and they were, it was so fashionable, blah, blah, blah. And then I hear the opposite side, which is, well, that story isn't about me, so I absolutely hate it. And so I guess my question is then, what are your takes, you know, on when you hear someone say like, oh, that wasn't for me and I absolutely can't stand it, you know, how you're supposed to tell them, well, it's not about you, you know, it's for someone else and you can either appreciate it or not, but, you know, you weren't the target.
My answer is you can unfollow me if you want. You know, you can only, you know, I was saying earlier, I get these heartfelt messages, which is wonderful, and I also get a ton of hate, death threats, and all of it, all the time. People on the internet seem to have time on their hands to do a lot with their lives. And they want, I think we hit on it earlier, they really want to empower themselves by taking down others. And the answer is, block them, move on.
And I think it's also very important that we like start to finally get to that place to recognize all trans people don't get along.
Yeah.
So we're not gonna all like the same music, the same movies, yeah. The same fashion. No, you can't sit with me, girl. You understand? Unless we had a trans event, then okay, here's a open seat. But like in the reality of our lives.
Even in the same house.
Even in the same house, exactly. We lived together and had to, and it's okay. You know, it was only when, you know, we only had conflict when basically Jen was trying to tell me that something is the best that is ever, is like she's defending and from some academic perspective or wherever that this thing is the best. And I'm like, to who, girl? You know. But that's the only time. Other than that, if someone says, you know, oh, I really wasn't, this wasn't for me or that, I'm like, I hear you, that wasn't for me either, or, you know, this wasn't, it wasn't my thing, or no, that wasn't created for you. It's like lemonade as well, or watching some of the conservative, you know, Beyonce, watching some of the conservative pushback to Beyonce's last two albums, really, when we got to realize Beyonce's a black woman. She is. I know that blonde weave and, you know, sometimes the good lighting and all that good stuff fools people, but she actually is a black woman. So, like, when she's doing her music and doing those things, sometimes some of the things she says, they're not going to be meant for you, and it's okay.
I would just add real quickly that I like to talk about art. I think that's what art is for, is to facilitate great conversation. I don't want there to ever be an easy answer of that was good or that was bad. To me, a measure of great art is its capacity for engendering complicated dialogue, and in that dialogue, we discover ourselves and each other, and it makes for a richer understanding of the world. So whenever anyone says, like, dismisses something like that, I mean, I would want to just push them into further conversation.
Hello, my name is Jasmine Jubilee G.
Hi.
I thank you for having this panel. Some comments and a question. I agree with you, Angelica, that trans folks don't get along with each. We are people, we have our own quirks, just like everybody else. So, but then we have some events like Transgender Day of Visibility and this Friday Trans March and Transgender Day of Remembrance in November to bring us together under a cause, but otherwise we're doing our own thing. And Rhys, I thank you for your comment. And are you aware that Susan Stryker did a documentary called Screaming Queens? In fact, this Friday at the end of Trans March, we're going to unveil the 100 block of Taylor Street as the Compton's Cafeteria Way. It's because in August, it's 50 years since the riot of the gay movement, not just transgender, and it's 3 years before Stonewall. The reason why I know all this because I'm one of the vice co-chairs of Trans March. I'm also a senior, and I'm also a woman of color. Last year, someone did a mini documentary on me named Jasmine's Jubilee. It was premiered at the Queer Women of Color Film Festival in early June last year. And then it was shown at the Transgender Film Festival. In that film festival, there was a film that came after mine about a Spanish showgirl who later became a politician in the Spanish parliament because she've done, anyway, that there are films that are letting people know about. So my question basically is, most of you are in your 20s, 30s, maybe 40s? Okay, I'm a senior. So because of Compton's Cafeteria 50th, the question is basically, are you or either some of you or all of you aware of this event? And are the theme of Trans March is, I'm sorry, I'm taking a long time, embracing our legacy, we are still here. Unfortunately, we borrowed that from Major, but she gave us permission. But anyway, so our past, our present, and our future, your take overall with films and social media.
Thank you. That's really interesting and cool to hear about what the 50-year anniversary of Compton's Cafeteria, and that's amazing. I'm really glad that you shared that with all of us. I'm just really enamored with queer and trans history and trying to learn as much as possible about it. And it's so, it feels even more necessary now, this moment in time we're finding ourselves in, to look backwards and really, really honor the people whose shoulders we're standing on. Because even though this kind of felt like it happened overnight, because in some ways it happened so quickly, there's just been, you know, half a century, obviously more centuries, you know, of labor and activism and sweat and blood. And, you know, trans history is something that's so invisible, and it's a part of the marginalization of trans people, you know, for generations that contributes to that. When I was doing the research for We've Been Around, one of the things that I really noticed, well, out of many things, was that around 1970, then, there was almost no documentation about the trans people's lives, especially trans people of color. Their lives were not documented. People who were, the more marginalized one is or was, the less there's a record of these lives. And that's not a coincidence, obviously. So I think we need to really, as queer and trans people, honor that history and look to the people who came before us and educate ourselves as much as possible, and really honor the elders and the seniors too. I wish I had more constant contact with queer and trans elders. So thank you for being here and talking with us and everything you're doing, co-chairing the Trans March, and that's just amazing. So thank you for that question.
Yeah. I just want to push that a little bit further too, and thank you for bringing up Compton, but there's also Dewey's and Black Hat, and in all these spaces what they had in common was that they were poor urban areas where what we would now call queer and trans people, mostly people of color and mostly sex workers, drag queens, hustlers, drug dealers and drug addicts, you know, the disposable according to the rest of society would gather, and they would be up all night in these 24-hour diners and donut shops, and the police wanted, you know, basically to get rid of them, and they would stigmatize them. And the reason that trans women in particular were so essential to all these is because there were laws on the books that prevented cross-dressing. And that's why the drag queens and transsexuals would get picked on the most. And they were the most visible part of our community. So we've always been the most visible part of our community and the most stigmatized and the most desired in an underground way. And sex work, especially as a part and parcel of our entire history of resistance, to this day, sex work funds so much more of our activism than we talk about in public. And it's a huge part of our story. So thank you for acknowledging those.
Yes, because if I was a sex worker, my funds would be down. They would, for trans tech, would be funded for 20 years. I promise you, because the it is stated, you know, as a trans woman of color, like, the way the dynamics are, and this is why her story, I'm really, really proud to be a part of a project like this, because you know, Paige, the character that I play, she's an attorney, and she's funny and she's beautiful and she's all these different things, but we're still in a world where no matter, it seems like, how respectable or how whatever that you are, you're still disposable. You're still, I mean, it's not just the girls who aren't passable who are, you know, getting killed, and that we're seeing pictures of our beautiful trans women of color who are being killed. So I don't even know why I brought that up.
No, it's just important. I mean, this is still happening. I mean, the same things that happened at Compton and Dewey's, and it's still happening today. You know, our girls are still out on the streets. You know, Tangerine, you know, for all of its exploitation, was still very much a true story. You can walk down to that donut time, and those girls are still there. I mean, girls just like them. I mean, that's a daily part of our existence, and we have to acknowledge that. It is part of our community. It's part of our story.
No internet questions.
Hi, I just want to say thanks to the panel, and I'm from London, or I'm from Ireland, but I live in London, and
you can talk with that accent all day. You can tell
the
story.
Keep going. Nice.
Well, for me, when I go to, I've been to numerous script writing panels, and friends have gone to like workshops and things like that, and I've been in situations where I've just been there with like a straight person, well, cisgendered, like heterosexual person, saying to me, like, for one instance, there was this someone making a short film about a trans woman who had to go back to their home in like Romania to kind of have this cathartic feeling with their family and but it was like very normative, and like, of course, it ended with tragedy as ever, and all of these like very simple, straightforward notions of like cisgendered people have of trans people. And I just wanted to ask you to go back to the thing you were saying, Jen, about people who haven't met trans people and what they wrote, like them writing about trans people, and like the disparity between an authentic experience of yourself writing about it and what they would write about it, like just kind of like little things that you, like the things that you said, you noticed, but like more specific kind of like the pitfalls that they go through, and what gets you about those compared to your own experience.
It drives me bonkers, and it drives me bonkers that it's within our own LGBT community that this happens frequently. So I was a screenwriting fellow at Outfest this year, so I had a 3-day lab, you know, with 4 other LGBTQ writers and, you know, 5 mentors and a bunch of really famous guest speakers and people from the industry. I saw, you know, a line in another script about, you know, a lesbian making a joke joke about, you know, like, oh, I don't have one of those because I'm a woman. Another one's saying, like, oh, she binds, so what's the point of dating her? Another script called Marsha Johnson, a drag queen, the writer of Carol and I got in a big fight because she said the characters of Tangerine were misogynists and that she's not a cis woman. And I mean, I encountered so much bullshit from my own LGB, you know, community. and meanwhile, half of my, like, we have these sessions where we sit down with mentors and they go over our script. And my feature script is about, you know, three trans women and their partners. And half of my sessions, and I'm sure this wasn't true of the other four, half of mine was, is it really like this? Does this happen? What does this mean? I've never heard of that. Can this really, you know, like, they were just completely clueless. Like, I'm still astonished at how far behind our own community is on trans issues. And it just, the kind of stories that we want to tell just would never occur to them. Like, we're invisible to a lot of our community. And so they are writing about us, and it is all those little details. It's specificity that makes art great. We talk about that all the time. And if you're only writing based on cliches, and this isn't just true of trans people, it's true writing across race. We see that a lot. I mean, I had a lot of anxiety at first about writing black characters because, like, in my feature, majority of the characters are black too. And that really scared me because I didn't want to do that. I didn't want to be tropey and rely on cliches that I've only learned from other TV shows and movies also written by white people. You know, you like have to be in conversation across difference in order to realize that difference in an effective, compassionate, honest, authentic aesthetic.
I would say not just in conversation, in relationship with, because there's a difference, you know, Jen and the way she's written my character and a lot of things have to do with the fact that we have a very close relationship, very intimate relationship, some of the ways that the little nuances of things that I would say. But you have a lot of people who come from a perspective of, yeah, talking about these things across things and theorizing and having perspective and things about the conversation, but without a long-term relationship across those dynamics of understanding and seeing how things change over time and how different dynamics affect folks from that area or from that community. I don't think you'll ever see a really truly authentic representation. If they themselves live in a world, in a bubble that is not affected by long-term relationships of diversity.
Oh yeah, and learning about our stories from people who have told them in a mediocre way who are not part of the community. And I can verify that when you put the Q on the end of LGBTQ, it's the same deal. Yeah. I actually have not encountered much misrepresentation because I haven't encountered much representation. I'll read all of your scripts. Send them to me.
We got time for one more question.
Thank you.
She's on it.
I was like breathing to say it, and you said
she can hope for this.
I live in a world of production specific to advertising and commercials, and I know in the past it's been very common for trans women to be the butt of the joke. And I'm really, really curious, Jeffrey, maybe more specific to you being a social individual, or figure, I should say.
Like I'm everything.
If you've been approached to do anything, whether that is, you know, providing insight or being the face of something or, you know, writing on something, or, you know, just in general, how you guys have seen that change, because a majority of it has been really negative. And I think it's still happening.
Yeah, It may be a shocker. I'm most known for my vines, and I've not made one single penny off of a vine. There is no makeup company. There's no, because obviously, right? There's no shoe company, right? There's nobody that's willing to work with someone who's genderqueer at this point. And it's such a... we're gonna change that. We're working on it. And I've gotten, you know, offers to do something off platform or to be a spokesperson for something like that. And it is like the cis person's experience and then, whoa, isn't this interesting? You know, sort of, I don't wanna be that note in selling their product. So it's gonna have to be a lot of communication.
when that deal comes to the fore.
And I think you even still, you have folks that are in our community that have done stuff for, like models who have, or people who've done makeup, a lot of showgirls, folks who've done makeup for a really long time, who would, in my opinion, be better spokespersons for makeup than Caitlyn Jenner for something like that. But you're looking at, again, a hierarchy of a lot of different things. So it's, yes, I'm not seeing the genderqueer representation, but I'm also not really seeing major companies coming to trans women yet to be the face of, represent a product, things like that. You know, trans tech, we have a relationship with Miller Coors. We know that Miller Coors had a historical issue with the LGBT community, but has since, you know, done a 360 and is also one of, they were the first corporation that has basically come for trans tech. So they do, you find people investing in the movement, but as far as an individual image that is anywhere from genderqueer to trans, I haven't seen it yet.
Well, I feel like we've just started to scratch the surface. There's so much more to talk about. But let's continue those conversations in the lobby and throughout the rest of the festival. And please join me in thanking these absolutely amazing people. Thank you.
And scene.